Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be with you. Before I talk about the things that I'm going to speak about, I do want, whenever I come back to Washington, I just have to share my favorite moment from being in office, which was I had landed at Reagan National Airport, and I was walking out, and there was an elderly couple who looked kind of nice. This sometimes can go south very quickly, but approached me. And the husband said, we just wanted to thank you for your public service. It must be difficult to work in public service. By the way, I always thought government was great, but it must be difficult to work in public service. And we just wanted to thank you from the bottom of our heart for all the work that you do. I said, that's so kind of you. Most of the people who approach me take a completely different tack. And I really appreciate the people who are supportive. And then the wife said, now, Mr. Cantor, what's your favorite part of serving in government? And I had heard a similar story about a Supreme Court justice years before, so I said, oh, that's easy, the opportunity to work with Peter Orszag. And as I turn to leave, I hear the wife ask the husband, who the hell is Peter Orszag? Favorite moment. Anyway, that was neither here nor there. I just had to share it. Okay, so what I want to do, and I'm going to leave some time for questions, is just talk about things. You all do your jobs better than someone, you know, lecturing up here could tell you how to do them. So I'm not going to really speak to the absolute core of what you do. I'm instead going to talk about many issues that are on the periphery of it, and hopefully some of that will be useful. We'll see. So we all know the population's aging. That is a core feature of your day jobs. The data are unambiguous in terms of demographic transition. One thing that I wanted to emphasize is that's repeated often. The consequences for the economy often are not fully traced through. So if you take these data, the population's aging, and while there is some increased labor force participation among older workers, which helps to offset the population aging, the net impact is unambiguously that workforce growth is going to be dramatically lower over the next decade than it was, for example, in the 1980s and 1990s. And if you roll forward, that means that we need to think significantly differently about the top line growth numbers that you read about in the newspaper. Basically, it may be that 50 is the new 40. I saw Chuck Yeager say yesterday, 90 is the new 70, so that's great. But I think we need to think that 2% is the new 3%, basically, in terms of economic growth. And the reason is, if you look at the bottom bars here, the darker parts, the potential labor force, because of that aging workforce, is just going to grow dramatically slower than it did in, you know, the 1990s or earlier. And unless you think productivity growth is going to dramatically expand to offset that, it means the top line growth number is going to come down by basically the differential in the workforce growth rate. So we're going to be growing at 70 to 80 basis points less than the 1990s, 100 basis points less than, I didn't show you the 1980s. And so if you had a number in your head of, 3% growth was good then, it means 2% growth is good today. And for whatever reason, it still feels like in the media depictions of economic activity, that core fact gets discounted too much. And we still have in our head that if we're growing at 2.5, that's kind of slow, whereas, you know, it used to be 3.5 was actually okay. They're effectively the equivalent of one another. Given the workforce growth rate. So that's point one. Point two is you all know that average life expectancy has been rising. We heard about that from my friend Gene earlier. That is the dominant paradigm that is pervasive throughout media depictions of our coming retirement crisis. And you can see it basically rising with a little dip over the past couple years, which is what I'm going to focus on in a second. But that is the dominant perspective, which focuses on the average. But the other thing that we need to remember is the age of average is basically over with regard to life expectancy. And what we've been seeing is a dramatic change in the gradient of mortality or the gradient of life expectancy across education and across income categories. So it was always the case that higher income, better educated people live longer than less educated, lower income people. But the degree to which that is true has expanded substantially over the past several decades. So what this shows you on the left is by quintile, the change in life expectancy at age 50. This is from a National Academy of Sciences panel that I co-chaired. And what you can see, we took people conditional on making it to age 50. What is the additional years of life that you have beyond that? And you can see for those who turned 50 in 1980, so they were born in 1930, there is an upward sloping gradient, but it's not that steep. Roll forward to those born in 1960, and this is obviously then projected forward in terms of additional life expectancy based on the mortality tables, and you get a very substantial increase in life expectancy for the top quintile, so congratulations everyone in this room, but basically flat to perhaps even declining life expectancy at the bottom. And the result of that then is that this gradient has become dramatically steeper across income and across education. And you can also see just the gap on the right having increased substantially also. Now this is starting to get a little bit more attention, but it's still the case that most discussions of Social Security and pensions just talk about rising average life expectancy and not this change in the distribution. All of the increase in mean life expectancy basically is occurring in the top 60% of the population over the past several decades, none of it in the bottom 40%. And just pause and think about that for a second. The bottom 40% of the U.S. population, the world's leading economy, basically has not experienced any increase in life expectancy in decades. It's really quite astonishing. One of the consequences of this is that our entitlement programs, and by the way, as an aside, all of your pension plans also, are becoming less progressive on a lifetime basis. Because intuitively what's happening is the higher earners are increasingly collecting their benefits over a longer and longer period of time compared to the median person or compared to the person at the bottom of the income distribution. And one of the things that our National Academy of Sciences panel did was quantify how big that effect is, and the answer is it's really big. So what we did is we took the present value of benefits for those turning 50, projected forward in Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, both disability and retirement, and supplemental security income, added them all together, and incorporated life expectancy, took the present value of that, and asked, you know, what is the total lifetime benefit that you can expect at age 50 at different parts of the income distribution? And maybe the easiest way of collapsing all of this is to just look in 1930, for those born in 1930, turning 50 in 1980, the present value of lifetime benefits for men is basically flat across the income distribution. So the top quintile gets $400,000 in benefits, the bottom quintile, $400,000 in benefits. The gap is zero. Roll forward to those born in 1960, and because of this change in the pattern of life expectancy, you see a dramatic difference where the top quintile is now getting $130,000 more in present value benefits compared to the bottom. That will be affecting anything that has a life annuity built into it, including traditional defined benefit plans. So this is a very big thing. Now the question is, why is this happening? And I should immediately say, we don't have full answers here, but I'm going to give you what I have suspected for the past 5 to 10 years and what now seems to be consistent with the evidence, which is the impact of stress and hope on health and mortality. And let me just pause and immediately say this is still a little bit subjective, but I think the evidence in favor of it is accumulating rapidly. So what this shows you upper left is the inequality in reported stress across the income distribution. For us and for Latin American countries, you would have thought that we sort of have less inequality than countries in Latin America along this dimension of stress. And what you see instead is that reported stress is higher for the bottom income quintiles in the US than in Latin American countries. And also the delta, the difference between the top and the bottom, that is how much stress declines as you go up the income distribution, that's also bigger in the United States. And I'd say also, it's not just reported stress, but the type of stress that seems to be affecting low and moderate income workers disproportionately. I'm on the road all the time. I have a certain amount of stress in my life, but I have more control over my day than someone whose schedule is not known to them until, you know, 12 to 24 hours ahead of time, who doesn't have adequate childcare or other family support. And so that it's not just the level of stress, but the type of stress in terms of whether you feel like you're in control of your life that affects things. You can see on the bottom left, this is very, very big in terms of not only life satisfaction, but also health outcomes. And then the final thing I'd point to on the right is also an astonishing change. All of this mortality difference, the good news, and I always want to leave with a little good news, which I'll also do at the very end of this. The good news is, while the gradient by life, by income and education is getting steeper, the racial gaps are actually declining. So the gap in life expectancy between whites and black Americans is declining. And that is consistent with this story, which is, if you look at the, it's really kind of striking, the degree of optimism. Even poor black families are more optimistic today than higher income white families. So this mortality thing really is about low and middle income white Americans losing hope and optimism, experiencing perceived stress. I'm not saying their lives are actually objectively more stressful than other groups. They're probably not. It's just the perception of that. And it's feeding into mortality in a striking way, which is then affecting Social Security, Medicare, and all of your pension programs at the same time. Okay, so now let's turn to a couple retirement topics. You've already heard about, and you all know about, the shift towards 401k plans. I do think, just to pause for a second on auto enrollment, because that is the shining example of the success of behavioral economics in influencing policy. So 15 years ago, when I was working on these issues at the Retirement Security Project, there was still a significant amount of low-hanging underbrush that needed to be cleared out of the way in order for defined contribution programs to move towards opt-out settings. And you see around that time, after some of the underbrush was cleared out of the way, and the general research findings showing dramatic improvements or increases in participation rates with an opt-out type of system, you see this significant uptick in the percentage of 401k plans that have auto enrollment. Now the question is, what is the net impact? Because there were a lot of questions that were raised after a few years. You get people into the plan, but you're opting them into pretty low contribution rates. Are you actually helping them? Participation rates by themselves don't seem to be the only thing that we care about. We care about what's actually happening in aggregate. And there have been a couple recent studies that have looked at that. Let me focus on the bottom left one, which actually comes from a study of when the Army moved to automatic enrollment into the Thrift Savings Plan. You were able to study sort of before and after pretty carefully. And what you see is there is a positive impact on total retirement savings. So the concern that you're opting people into a contribution rate that's too low, which then led to this Save More Tomorrow type of plans, that seems like it's present, but may have been overblown in the earlier studies. There is a, I don't want to overstate it, but there is an increase in total contributions and total savings in the plans, entirely basically from the low to moderate income part of the income distribution. So you're not really affecting higher income workers that much. It's basically getting lower income workers into it. There also is, however, an increase in debt that you see on the other side of the balance sheet when people are opted into 401k plans. So that may be a little bit concerning. We don't actually have definitive evidence on what happens to net worth, which is ultimately the question, from these sorts of plans. The only thing I'd note is the really big thing in terms of additional debt is on mortgages. And since that's also backed by an asset, it's not entirely clear that we should be that worried about the additional debt, because at least it's also associated with an asset. And so the net here is unclear, but I'd say it's more promising than we thought it was 5 years ago in terms of the overall picture, especially for low to moderate income workers on 401k plans. My bigger concern, there's been a lot of focus on the accumulation stage, and I think that's warranted. We're still far from the report that's coming out from This organization this morning also shows that, you know, for younger workers, there's inadequate retirement savings. I think all of that is appropriate. But when you look at the numbers, you're talking about, depending on what you do with housing equity, maybe a quarter to a third, maybe up to 40% of people undersaving. That's significant. But what about the people who have been saving adequately? We have not even started to really scratch the surface of the decumulation phase for defined contribution plans and what someone's supposed to do if they've done the right thing and they've saved up and then they get to retirement, what should they do? And what you see here is, let me just focus on this. So you reach age 65 and you've got your average life expectancy. I was showing you some of the average life expectancies by income, but you have the average life expectancy of, you know, 85 or whatever. But that's an average. That's an expectancy. You also have a 20% chance of living past 90 and a 10 to 15% chance of living past 95 and so on and so forth. So what is it that you're supposed to do? And many of you may be focused on the same problem with your own families, which is you've got someone who's reaching that age. What are they supposed to do? Because there are no good options. You can just do a phased withdrawal, which will, from your accumulated 401k, which will leave you exposed to that probability that you're going to live to 95, and you may run out of money. The alternative is to buy a life annuity, which very few people do, at least to date. And the core problem is, for the typical person, not surprisingly, the annuities are priced off of the annuitant population, not the overall population. The annuitant population tends to be higher income, better educated, longer lived. And the result of that, the evidence suggests, is that you pay in present value a cost of 10 to 15, maybe as much as 20% in expected value based on your own typical person mortality for purchasing an immediate life annuity. That's a very expensive insurance policy to buy. And so you're sort of stuck. There's no way out of that dilemma. The only true product that provides the insurance against outliving your assets is an immediate life annuity, but for the typical person, the pricing is not that attractive. And so you don't have any great option. I think this needs a lot more focus, including options of opting people into annuities that begin at age 85, that at least take some of the tail risk out of the way. I mean, there are other countries that are experimenting with different things. My point is just the decumulation phase has gotten like 5% of the attention, and it should start to get a much larger share of our concern and our attention as people are reaching retirement, with those defined contribution plans being increasingly a dominant part of their retirement portfolio. Final point I want to make. One of the explanations for why people don't annuitize historically has been that they want to leave a bequest. You annuitize you build up $500,000, $1 million in your 401k, you annuitize it, you die the next day, and you leave nothing to your heirs. So if that were the major explanation, then what I'm about to show you, which has stunned me, wouldn't make any sense. So I'm skeptical that that's the big explanation. And the thing that has stunned me is there has been just a dramatic decline in the ownership of life insurance in the United States over the past three decades. This is something that I did not know. Both cash value and term. I should also say that the other thing, I lived in Washington in my early to mid-30s, and my personal health strategy used to be to take out larger and larger term life insurance policies on myself. And they'd send out a doctor, and he'd say, "You can get the term life insurance." And I'd say, "I must be healthy," which was not really the optimal personal health strategy, but it worked for a while. It was very convenient. So the question is, what is going on here? Because again, if bequests were a big deal, you would think that people would not be discarding their life insurance. So one explanation that, there's been a lot of study on this. So one is, well, with regard to cash value, maybe changes in the state tax or in the tax law explains it. Maybe demographic shifts explain it. And the short answer I can tell you from the empirical literature is neither of those explain what's going on. So within each demographic group, within each socioeconomic group, even controlling for tax policy changes, there still is this huge puzzle. So the second thing that might be going on is, well, let's go back to the life expectancy thing. Presumably, the desire to have life insurance goes down if your life expectancy goes up. You don't need life insurance during, you know, the next 10 years if the probability of dying in that period of time goes down significantly. And since life expectancy has been increasing, maybe that helps to explain what's been going on here. The problem is, remember, I said life expectancy has been going up really fast at the top of the income distribution, and it's flat to down at the bottom of the income distribution. And so if you look at the pattern of what's been happening on life expectancy, you would expect that explanation would cause a disproportionate decline in life insurance among higher earners, because it's for them that life expectancy has been going up. Instead, you find exactly the opposite, which is life insurance purchases plummeting at the bottom of the income distribution. They're also going down at the top, so this is pretty much across the board. But an explanation that's based on life expectancy alone, I think, will struggle with these facts. So I'm left with a little bit of a puzzle about, and there's also a whole bunch of industrial organization kind of things, the demutualization of insurance companies and the fact that life insurance is basically only sold by the mutual companies. Term life insurance declined less than cash value life insurance, and that may be because it's much easier to buy term life insurance online, and there is some empirical evidence suggesting that when that happened, prices plummeted and it may have helped cushion the blow. So there may be a little bit of sort of channel effects going on too, but I'd say this is another significant puzzle, at least to me, and it's obviously around your world, not directly in it. I want to just end on one, because this is all pretty depressing, and you heard a lot of depressing stuff before. It's all, and we don't want to end on that. So I'm gonna end on one positive note, where I'm gonna part company very slightly with my colleague Gene, which is on healthcare. So I'm much more of an optimist on healthcare cost trajectory than Gene suggested. We've seen a massive deceleration in healthcare costs pretty much across the board, in private insurance, in Medicare, and in Medicaid. I'm gonna focus on Medicare because Medicare is not cyclical. It's not affected by the business cycle. And there's also not been a dramatic expansion in coverage. Instead, coverage in Medicare is going up gradually as people age into it. And yet, you've seen basically over the past 6 or 7 years, a decline in real spending per beneficiary in Medicare. If I had stood up when I was in office and said, I think real spending per person in Medicare will fall, to a group like this, everyone would have laughed at me. And yet that's exactly what's happened, far exceeding what one could have expected. I think spending a lot of my time out with hospital executives, insurance executives, and what have you, that the combination of digitization, which is necessary but not sufficient, and perceived changes in the payment system, which are not yet fully in place, but there's an expectation that they will increasingly move away from fee-for-service payment, is causing a lot of behavioral change that is then resulting in this much slower utilization growth than we've seen historically. Now, Gene mentioned that the actuaries have a different view, and let me just focus on the far right, because what the actuaries keep doing, and I'm growing increasingly frustrated with them, is they keep saying, okay, but that was temporary, and it's about to explode again. Okay, but that was temporary, and it's about to explode again. So they're literally projecting that we're gonna go back to 7-8% Medicare growth. You can see the actuals here, and each time these projections are, we're about to see, on the right, we're about to see this big increase. They did it again with the 2017 and actually the Health Affairs article that just came out a couple weeks ago. Same thing again. So I'm gonna just end by saying this, and I think we'll have time for a couple minutes of questions. I am willing to take a bet that with anyone in the room or anyone anywhere, that the actuaries are much too pessimistic about Medicare growth, in particular Medicare cost growth, both for 2018 and for 2019, 2020, and 2021. So Philip Tetlock, who studies kind of expert forecasting, says you have to be very specific and not vague, like I think there's some risk that this will happen. I'm gonna be very specific. I will take the under on the published Medicare growth rates in Health Affairs for any year between 2018 and 2021. I did. Don't tweet this publicly. I did have a bet a couple years ago with one of the CMS actuaries over a Diet Coke. I won that bet, and they are not betting anymore, but they keep publishing the same thing. Thank you very much for having me, and we have some time for questions. Any questions?
Hi, Peter. Mark Miller with Reuters. I wanted to ask a question about your point on declining progressivity in programs like Social Security and DB pensions. For both of those areas, Social Security and pensions, what recommendations do you have on ways to address that, to the declining progressivity at the low income end of the spectrum?
So that's a great question. So two comments. One is, actually in the National Academies of Sciences report that came out probably 2 years ago, we walked through a whole variety of things that one could do. I mean, the easiest thing one could think of is to make the social, let's focus on Social Security for a second, to make the annual benefit computation more progressive, so that you're offsetting the kind of effect of differential mortality through
changing
bed points, making them more progressive. You could also imagine doing this. Peter Diamond and I, who were early to this differential mortality thing, proposed now more than a decade ago changes on the tax side that would also help to make the system more progressive on a lifetime basis. So that's, you know, the maximum taxable earnings base and what have you. So there are steps you could take. Each of them have pros and cons, but the National Academy of Sciences report goes through all of them, including for Medicare, by the way.
Peter, oh yeah, hi. Bill Arnone, the National Academy of Social Insurance, the other academy. Talking about the decumulation phase in 401k plans and the inability of the private sector annuity market to satisfy a need, how would you react to enabling people to actually purchase in Social Security an enhanced benefit that has the features that you would think an annuity needs, optimal features? How would you react to a proposal along those lines?
I think I'm in favor of better priced annuities for the typical person, and that's obviously one way of doing it. Now, we need to realize, because of the point that I made, you're going to wind up providing a, quote, public subsidy, inevitably, when you do that, because you're not going to be pricing, you're going to presumably price at the population average. The people who are purchasing the individual products today are going to find that even more attractive. And they're going to purchase those also and then benefit as a result, because you're not pricing just off of the annuitant pool, you're pricing off of the whole population. I'm willing to tolerate that kind of fiscal cost because, I don't see any great options. But I'd also say I don't think that's the fundamental problem. I mean, I think that is a problem and we need a better product. But there's also just a huge amount of inertia and reluctance to go down the annuitant path. And so we are left with this question of whether we make it mandatory, or we make it mandatory for a little part of it, or we opt people into annuities that they can opt out of. Because I think if it's totally voluntary, even if the products are better, you're going to get very, very low take up. The final thing I'd say on this is I do think there's room for a product that sort of combines all the things that someone turning 65 or 70 wants without having to shop around. So a reverse mortgage that lets you stay in your home for as long as you're alive, long-term care insurance that protects against the biggest risk you might face in the healthcare system, and an annuity so that you don't outlive your savings, all combined in one package, and those have different features, but you don't have to go kind of find lots of different providers. It's sort of one-stop shop, nice and easy, simple. That, I think, might help, but I think in general, the biggest issue is going to be people don't focus on the need for an annuity until it's too late. And I will also just make one little note, which is count me as a skeptic on, there's probably no harm, but count me as a skeptic that financial education, which is the typical place where people go, that actually works. I've seen no evidence outside of high school programs that providing financial education actually does much of anything. So it seems like it's a false hope to keep holding that out as being the solution to a lot of these problems.
Peter, from
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Join me in thanking Peter one more time.